This is the Literary License Podcast with your hosts, Vicky Ray, John Wilson, and Keith Shorgo, discussing book to screen and everything in between, coming at you from the UK and USA.
They keep it real.
Everything will be fine.
Everything will be fine. Oh, it hurts me. Please help me.
Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. I am the surgeon. You have lost our baby. You are bleeding very badly. The only way I can save you is to separate you from Dominique.
Am I going to die?
No. You will be fine. Everything will be fine.
Sisters, sisters, there were never such devoted sisters. Never had to have a chaperone, no sir. I'm here to keep my eye on her. Caring, sharing, every little thing that we are wearing. When a certain gentleman arrived from Rome, she wore the dress and I stayed home. All kinds of weather, we stick together, the same in the rain or sun. Two different faces, but in tight places, we think and we act as one. Uh-huh. Those who've seen us know that not a thing can come between us. Many men have tried to split us up, but no one can. Sister, and Lord help the sister that comes between me and my man. All kinds of weather, we stick together, the same in the rain or song. Two different faces, but in tight places, we think and we act as one. Uh-huh. Those who've seen us know that not a thing can come between us. Many men have tried to split us up, but no one can. Lord help the mister who comes between me and my sister.
Good way to get sick. Very, very sick. That's how I got so sick. Someone called me on the telephone!
What's going on here? Who are you?
My name is Grace Collier, and I write for the Staten Island Panorama, and I must use the telephone.
No! No! Don't give it to her! Go on!
She won't use it, Arlene.
Hello, welcome to the Literary License Podcast, and today we'll be covering Sisters, the 1972 classic by Brian De Palma, and Goodnight Mommy, the Austrian 2014 film. And before we get started, let's find out who we have with us today. And of course, we have our regular co-host, Vicky. Say hello, Vicky.
Hey, everybody. What's up?
And we have our favorite guest co-host, Will Millar. Say hello, Will.
Hey, gang.
And John will not be with us because he is tied at work. So as soon as he sits there and unties that umbilical cord to his boss, he'll be back with us.
Poor baby. I feel so bad. They're working him like a dog.
So before we get started, let's discuss what we've been up to in the last week. So, Will, what have you been up to in the past, since last time we saw you?
Yeah, well, if you guys remember, I was talking about expanding what I've been doing on Medium and working on this
exhibition.
And so I'm hard at work on part three of that, and we'll be continuing a study of it into the foreseeable future, and just working on the final edit of the next book, which I hope to have out early next year.
Cool beans.
Excellent. Yeah. And what about yourself, Vicky? What have you been up to in the past week?
Well, you've been keeping me busy with our new endeavors for the next season. And other than that, it's full swing state race season and BMX for Asher. He's got a lot of stuff. He's doing karate and always with the kids for some reason. I do have a life other than that, but mostly it's been family a lot lately. And just watching... catching up on Game of Thrones. I've got my hypothesis for the next two episodes, what's going to happen. I mean, I'm not going to say any spoilers, but I got a good idea what's going to happen. I hope I'm wrong, though. But other than that, I've been watching a lot of Amazon Prime. They got some really good stuff on this month. And watching the new Sabrina on Netflix, because I really love it. I'm sure that the Christian church is just rolling over on that series. And other than that, just hanging out with you a lot more lately on the computer.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty much
it. He's trying to kill me. He's killing me.
And myself, well, I finished watching on Amazon Prime or on their sub channel called Stars. I watched Heathers, the series that came out last year. Very good series. It kind of was banned in America. It was made, the studios weren't very happy with it because it does take, well, it kind of pokes the fun at the far left and the far right. And so
then there's some school violence or something.
Well, it wasn't the school violence that really upset them. It had the feeling that, well, if you remember from the original 1980s classic with Winona Ryder and Kristen Slater,
right,
it's about these two outsiders who are killing the cliques, and the cliques happen to be
cheerleaders, yeah,
and football players. The TV series takes everything and turns it on its head. So basically what we have now is the geeks are the sheiks of the school now. And so we got this one woman who's very PC, overweight, and she's the queen bee with this transsexual guy that's also a Heather, because his name is Heath, so they made him a Heather. This
so they flipped it.
This mixed race girl who's a lesbian, who they kick out of the Heathers and they find out that she's straight. So it kind of switches on the head, but these people are the evil ones. And everyone else, the straight white Americans are the good ones. And it kind of made up everyone upset. But if you get a chance to see it, it's got a fantastic soundtrack.
Everybody's a bunch of touchholes over here now in the States. I'm so sick of it.
Well, there is a lot of violence.
We grew up on violence, though. All of a sudden,
yeah. But what you don't understand is in the American culture that you have at the moment, this is school violence. We're talking about kids killing kids. We're talking about shooting up schools. We're talking about blowing up schools. We're talking about killing as many kids as possible so you can get your name in the press. And that's what.
Well, then I understand completely why this series has been banned. What is it on Prime?
It's on Amazon Prime. It's on their sub-channel called Stars.
Oh, I don't have Stars. Stars will put anything on. They don't care.
Well, it was supposed to be on. It was supposed to be originally aired on Paramount, but what basically happened is that once it was made, they got cold feet. So they kind of did they kind of put out the pilot episode, and they got really, everyone was like, oh, we're going to watch this. And then they thought, oh, well, we can't show this. So then what they did was they waited 6 months, and then they put them all on like within 2 days and then got rid of it. And then they cut it as well.
Yeah. So, well, considering we just had a fresh school shooting, and then there was one just down the road from us, a Mesquite. So, you know, people, I don't know. Remember when we were kids, everybody used to drive around in upstate New York. Everybody had a gun rack with a gun in the back of their car. We never thought about that. Everybody had guns, but we never thought about bringing them to school. I'll never understand that.
Well, it's because we bullied people face to face.
That's right.
Different days.
We didn't need to have a gun.
We were on drugs. You're happy.
When everybody's stoned, everybody's happy.
But if anyone gets a chance to see it, I highly recommend it. I really enjoyed it.
Heathers, right?
It does end, you know, they do end the series quite well with an interesting nod what season two was supposed to be. Season two was supposed to take place in the 1800s. So it was quite interesting.
Oh, cool.
But of course, we'll never get to see season two. So obviously.
Oh, shoot. Really?
Yeah. And besides that, my guests have all left. Chelsea and Shannon are headed back. Debs is now back.
They're from Oklahoma, aren't they?
Well, one's in Arizona, one's in Oklahoma. And Debs is gone. So today I spent the time fumigating and cleaning the house for once. So getting everything back.
I kind of figured you were going to be lonely. I know you miss Debs. You don't want to admit it, but I know you do.
No, I miss not having them around, but I did miss my space.
Everybody does. I get you.
You know, I quite like my Saturdays and Sundays, you know, where, you know, Sundays I spend editing the podcast and Saturdays.
Right.
I like, you know, I'm lucky, you know, I put on my pajama bottoms, I put on a t-shirt and I fluff around the house like a nomadic old man. So, yeah. So, yeah, but it's good to get back to my normal routine. So
my kids want to drag me out to that restaurant. You see that video where you commented on, I post on Facebook where the waitress screams at you?
Oh, yeah.
I got one in Dallas. Right. She wants to go to that tomorrow. If I do go, I'll make sure I videotape it or go Facebook Live.
I could marry her. She's a woman.
I know. I think it's just great. People thought it was a real waitress. It's like, no, no, no. It's a chain. They put funny hats on you and they insult you and you pay for it. It's almost like S&M. You know?
Shit, I insult people for free.
I know. No kidding.
But other than that, we got some fantastic things coming up for season three. So we've been doing a lot of organization for that.
You guys are going to love it. It's going to be great. You must listen to us. We're fabulous.
And we've also updated our website to show we're going to have some series formatting going on with some new co-hosts joining us. And if you go to www.llpodcast.com, you will see what's a little bit of a hint of what's in store for you. We'll have more information in July, August time.
Yippers.
So, for no too much to do, let's talk about the 1973 or 72 film. Sorry, seems to.
I got 73.
Got 73.
It's funny, yeah.
Okay, it's a 72 horror slasher film, but it says it's a 73 film in my research. So, it was released in the spring of 73. That's what it is.
Oh. Okay, yeah. Somewhere right around there.
Yeah.
I don't know why that's so.
But it's a classic film by Brian De Palma, and let's get started on some brief history about it. So, Will, do you want to start us off on what you've learned about Sisters, the 1972/1973 Brian De Palma?
There you go. Okay, cover the bases.
Sure. Just a brief synopsis on it. The Wikipedia is that inquisitive journalist Grace Collier, played by Jennifer Salt, is horrified when she witnesses her neighbor fashion model Daniel Breton, played by Margot Kidder, violently murder a man. Panicking, she calls the police, but when the detective arrives at the scene and finds nothing amiss, Grace is forced to take matters into her own hands. Her first move is to recruit private investigator Joseph Larch, Charles Dunning, who helps her to uncover a secret about Daniel's past that hasn't both seen double. All right, so this was De Palma's... where do I begin with this? There's so much going on in this movie.
Exactly.
I don't know really where to begin. First of all, it's another one of his erotic thrillers, which are great. You guys had me back for which one was it the last time?
Dress to Kill.
Yes.
Dress to Kill. That's right. This is another one in those in that genre. De Palma is a genius for kind of wielding sex like a weapon. I don't know. We can start right off with the game show that is the opening.
Right. Oh my God. I couldn't stop laughing about the game show.
Yeah. So, you know, the gist of the game show is it's a candid camera setup where a model is portraying, she's acting like a blind girl. She's got like sunglasses on and a cane and whatnot. Supposedly blind, and the gist of it is she thinks she's in a room by herself and she starts to undress and there's a guy standing right behind her that ostensibly she's unaware of. So this is just it's a concentrated dose of voyeurism, and that's his jam. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So
anyway, some of the stuff that he hits on in this movie is there's the twin motif. There is the false memory stuff going on. There's mind control. It's shot in Staten Island. Now, I don't know if you guys are aware of what was actually going on at the time in Staten Island.
Son of Sam? Well,
what's that now?
No, it wasn't Son of Sam.
Son of Sam is a few years later, but that's really interesting too. No, the Willowbrook scandal happened in Staten Island right at the time this movie was going on. So this movie's released. It may have been in 72 that the Willowbrook scandal broke.
Willowbrook, you're going to tell our listeners what Willowbrook scandal is, sweetie.
Oh, I'm about to. So Willowbrook was this mental hospital that was basically, you guys remember American Horror Story Season 2?
Right.
Okay, so imagine if that was a documentary. That's Willowbrook. There were actual Nazi doctors brought over from Operation Paperclip, injecting hepatitis into homeless mental patients. As dark as it was, this stuff was happening. And Geraldo Rivera won his one and only Peabody Award for
exposing it.
Filming a documentary based on what was happening back then. You guys remember ever hearing about that?
Yeah, absolutely. He exposed quite a few. He was exposing stuff up in Saranac Lake in upstate New York about where, you know, asylums for the, you know, mentally, you know, insane, challenged, whatever, because there was a lot of nasty stuff going on back then that people were unaware of.
Yeah. So Willowbrook is that was the crown jewel of the asylum horror story stuff that was happening. 70s, and that's that was terrible. In Staten Island, and that's where the crooked doctor was also. All right, so that was one big signal that De Palma was like sending out. The other thing that's really crazy is how he tied in mind control and then a Canadian sinister doctor. So that's all about MK Ultra. There's these two doctors up in Canada named Sidney Gottlieb and Ewan McGregor, who were all about drugging random people and hypnotizing them and getting them to be convinced in false memories or of false memories. And so if you think of, you know, I'm going to jump ahead from the very beginning to the very end, and then we can all talk about some other stuff.
Right.
The very ending of the movie is the investigator who's been kind of tracking the events of the whole movie, which are bananas, all along. She figures it all out, but then gets hypnotized and mind controlled, and at the very end she's like a robot and is, you know, saying there was no murder because I saw nothing.
Right up into the very end on that, spoiler alert. I was surprised. I'd forgotten that he had done that to her, actually, until the I thought she was cured, you know, then she wasn't completely.
So De Palma was taking some really sketchy real life events that really, you know, we should all know about, you know, but we don't because it just gets covered up, and kind of just turned it into this crazy, you know, sexy erotic thriller type movie, just with all kinds of crazy Easter eggs in it. So anyway, what did you guys think about it?
I thought
what's interesting about Sisters is basically this is Brian De Palma's first film that would actually start the rest of his career. As you once stated, this the pseudo-sexualness of it that would actually be evident in things like Carrie, Phantom of the Paradise, Dressed to Kill, Body Double, Raise, and then we also have the split personalities that we also and the psychological situations that we have in films like Dressed to Kill and Carrie Again, and you know this, and this is also the film style that. That would start off the Brian De Palma's major film. Because before this film, basically Brian De Palma was known as making comedies. Lots of comedies of Robert De Niro, because he basically got Robert De Niro's film career started. He did High Mom and other films like that. And they were kind of like student-y kind of films with a political slant to them. Where here in Sisters, what we got is Brian De Palma taking his craft, changing, going from comedies to this horror, pseudo-sexual filmmaking that he would now become famous for, and it would actually mark his career. He's also was able to take all his Alfred Hitchcock inclinations and put those into one film, and with, you know, the split screen, he would perfect it in this film, and of course he would carry this on through Carrie and other films like this. So I find that Sisters is quite interesting, the simple fact that when you do watch Sisters and then you watch all the Brian De Palma films after that, it's almost like this is the beginning of a great career, and here we go.
Right.
And this is and all these themes here. And I also like the simple fact that there's a lot of nods to Alfred Hitchcock. We got nods to Psycho, like with, you know, Crane going up to Norman Bates' house. We got Jennifer Saul's character going into the asylum and that same craning shots and stuff like this. We have the voyeuristicness of Rear Window, but then we got the luridness of Frenzy from Alfred Hitchcock going on. And it's quite interesting to, you know, it's almost like, you know, if we're going to look at Brian De Palma's films as a whole, this is like one of the crown jewels that's going to actually spark what his career is going to turn out to be later on in life. Well, through the 70s and 80s. Of course, he lost it a bit by the millennium. So
that was a shame. We were talking about that before. You're talking about Margot Kidder?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she hit a wall and kind of had a real mental break for a while. And, it's pretty rough. I hope she's doing. Does it, anybody know?
That's what I was asking you. I hadn't, you know, other than that, I can't remember. It's been some time since that happened, but I've not seen her on anything.
She's appearing in a lot of TV shows. You'll see her in comedy. She was in Arrested Development for a while. She appeared in another comedy with she was Carrie Fisher's friend in a comedy show that was on. She does appear. She does make appearances now. She does a lot of TV stuff. She's older, she would be.
Exactly.
I think that, you know, Margot Kidder, I mean, this is like her, my interesting thing about Sisters, this is, Brian De Palma had a habit of taking these actors and turning them into superstars afterwards because of the use of his film, Robert De Niro, as we mentioned before. But what we also have is, you know, we got Margot Kidder. This is like her first starring role. Charles Durning appears as well.
Right, right.
And, you know, Margot Kidder went from strength to strength. You know, she went from this to Black Christmas, which was another winner at the box office. And, of course, Superman, which kind of made her and broke her at the same time.
What do you mean broke her? Do you think she was like stigmatized into that role as Lois Lane or?
Unfortunately, yes. I think, you know, you got to remember that films in the 70s and 80s, if it became very, very popular, Christopher Reeve's a Superman. He never got rid of that Superman.
That's true.
Stigma or anything like that. And I think Margot Kidder kind of fell into that. I don't think the Amityville Horror helped much. Things matter, you know, helped her a lot after Superman. But, you know, I
didn't really think of her as Lois Lane, though, when I saw the Amityville Horror. It didn't really cross my mind. I guess, I don't know.
I hate to jump in, but I think Karen Allen was in Amityville Horror, wasn't she?
No, it was Margot Kidder. She played...
It was Margot Kidder? Okay.
I think the reason...
First one, anyway.
Yeah, I mean, Margot Kidder is one of these kind of actresses, but then again, I'm not too versed on her career as a whole, but I do know that she did a lot of stage work and stuff like this. So maybe she went, you know, maybe she left Hollywood behind and did a lot of stage work, or maybe she maybe gone back to Canada. She's French Canadian. So maybe she started doing a lot of Canadian productions that I'm not aware of. I mean, I didn't do an extensive search on Margot Kidder, but you know, maybe she got fed up with the whole Hollywood things. Cause I mean, she is a Canadian actress and maybe she went on to do other stuff that, you know, that we wouldn't really know about, sort of thing, which is possible. So, but I mean, as far as Margot Kidder's psychological breakdown or whatever like this, I think, you know, I think that what then she just didn't know where she was or what she was doing. Wasn't that what it was?
She went homeless or something for a while, and she had somehow had lost her teeth, and she was just not knowing where she was, and they couldn't find her. I mean, it was like some kind of, I don't know if it was a breakdown, it was an episode, you know, extraordinaire, I know, but I mean, she disappeared for a while, and they said she was living out on the streets.
Yeah. Oh, that's rough, man. It's
I know somebody, I mean, when you're like almost Hollywood royalty to, you know, come down to that, you know, I mean, because she was really, she's probably still a fantastic person. I mean, it's just a shame things like that happen to certain people.
Hollywood is a pretty rough scene for some people, man. That's really, you know, who the hell knows what kind of crazy stuff she ran into.
Well, actually, it's saying that she passed away here, May 13th of 2018.
Oh, man. Well, you know, she was great in this. You know, one of the things that this is just a layer of De Palma's genius. So you've got that game show, right? Mm-hmm. And the whole gist of the game show is this guy going to be a perv and check out her boobs, all right? And I'm gonna talk about Margot Kidder's boobs here for a good solid 5 minutes. I just want
to well, they were so prominent in the movie, though.
Yeah, honestly, they are. So they're really a lot of the acting in this movie is done by her boobs. So the game show is this guy going to be a creep and then stare at her boobs? And everybody in the audience votes yes. And that's really tense, too, because this is a black guy staring at a white woman in the year 1972 when people were still really freaking touchy about this subject, you know? So, again, De Palma is making everyone uncomfortable, and that's one of the, you know, he doesn't make you frightened, really. He makes shit really tense and just awkward, you know? So, anyway, back to Margot Kidder's boobs. So the gist is this guy going to be a creep and stare at them? And he doesn't. He does the right thing, and then he ends up going on a date with her, which, you know, this leads to a course of events that her boobs are basically in a negligee for probably another half hour or so throughout the movie. They're just prominent. And so he didn't creep on her, but as the audience, we've all collectively creeped on Margot Kidder's boobs now for, I don't know, a half hour. So basically, the problem is kind of messing with us. And he brings it back to this. Don't think that this is an accident, because at the very end of the movie, creepy MK Ultra Nazi doctor has his hand just on her boob. And again, like, he's ratcheting on it. And it's almost as if, like, the hero of the movie, which was Margot Kidder's boobs, is in the ultimate peril right now. And, you know, who's going to rescue them? Crazy, you know, twin Margot Kidder, who's actually also the same Margot Kidder all along, which we haven't even really gotten to yet. I just kind of wanted to touch on that, though, because it's just, that's De Palma right there. Like, he just uses sex like a wrestler uses a folding chair. That's kind of just, I really kind of wanted to get that out because it's just genius what he does there.
I thought the guy was totally creepy, though.
Oh my goodness.
I love William Finley. He's fantastic. Yeah. William
Finley. He was just so creepy, though. Yes. I mean, he was nice kind of creepy. He got the birthday cake and all that other stuff. But he was creepy, though, even though he didn't.
Who do you think was creepy? The doctor or the guy that.
Both of them. But no, the guy from the
game show.
Game show. I didn't find him creepy.
I didn't find him creepy. I found him, to be honest, what's quite interesting with the pseudo-sexualness that we get in Brian De Palma films, he always has a political agenda going on here. And then what we have here is we got this black man who wins his prize as a dinner for two at the African Room.
did you guys think that was a little, like, you know, it was kind of racist almost?
But that was the point of it. That was the point.
Yeah, he's...
Right, I know, but I mean...
Uncomfortable. Again, it's De Palma. He uses political... He uses anything he can to make you, you know, squeamish, he will. And race makes people about as squeamish as sex. It's the two things that Americans are really touchy about.
We're such a puritanical society what a bunch of hypocrites we are.
But this also, I mean, what's also interesting in the, you know, when he wins the prize for the African Room, if you're familiar with the early stuff, you know, The Wedding and the other films that he made, there is a message that he has in all his earlier comedies about the Black Panthers. So this is us carrying those from, and it's carrying it into,
right,
you know, into the Sisters.
He doesn't discriminate, basically.
Yeah. And also, but, you know, I think what we'll do real quickly is we're going to cut to a commercial break and get to the trailer, and then we'll be right back to discuss Sisters more fuller.
Amazon. Oops, wrong Amazon. Although we both contain an array of diversity, the rainforest with all of its animals and us with all of our products, come check us over today and find all the products you need quickly and efficiently. And buy it with one click. And now you can even use us to donate to your favorite charities using Amazon Smile. Amazon Smile is worth your while. come check us out today.
Conjoined twins called Siamese challenge life at their first breath. Some twins have been separated and lead normal lives. Others never can. Sisters. They were once one in body and perhaps one in mind. Danielle and Dominique. One loving, one hating, one innocent. The other... Where does Danielle end and Dominique begin?
Remember.
He's a freak! Freak. Oh, he's a freak! 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 Freak!
Sisters. Rated R.
Morning face. You get it when you don't sleep well. This is what happened to Linda.
Morning, guys.
Good morning. Ah, what is that thing?
It's me, Linda.
Oh, my God, it talks! Run!
No, it's me, Linda, from HR.
It looks hungry! Save the children! Save them! Stay back! I've got mace!
Ow! That went in my eyes!
Quit moving!
It's called beauty sleep for a reason. And there's never been a better time to get some.
Get 20% off IKEA Sultan mattresses. IKEA, love your home.
Hello, welcome back to Literary License Podcast. And we're discussing Sisters, the 1972/1973 Brian De Palma classic. So as we were going, leaving, we were talking about the racism that we had in Sisters. And I have to sit there and say, when they went to the African room, or the place to eat. I don't know what kind of food they were serving because they were only there for drinks. But did you get a chance to check out the security men and their grass skirts and their tuxedo tops?
Yeah. Yeah. It kind of reminded me of the 1930-something King Kong movie there for a second with the natives on the Skull Island.
Because I was watching that. I was going, okay, it's like, you know, when he wins, when he, you know, first of all, she wins a set of steak knives. So it's like, okay, a set of knives, which is quite, you know, in these game shows in the 70s, everyone went home with a set of steak knives because it was the thing to do. But when you got the thing in the African room, I think you could tell that he was kind of bothered by it. But I like that Brian De Palma did a close up of his face and he went, and he saw the look on his face and he got it and he's like, oh, okay, sort of thing. And I quite like that because it did show that, you know, it's Brian De Palma's black comedy coming out here at the same time as it's showing some, you know, political correctness that should be going on here that's not going on. And I thought Brian De Palma was very, very clever being able to do that balancing act. So it is funny and you're supposed to laugh because it's like a black comedy sort of system. But at the same time, you know that it's definitely wrong what's happening here.
Right.
Which is even more topped off with the simple fact that when you go to the African room and you actually see the restaurant, it's even more wrong than him winning the government prize.
Like I said, it was like Skull Island meets New York City. That's what it reminded me of.
You know, can we go back to what the hell were the rules of the actual game show? Like, I thought that the participants in the game show were the ones who were supposed to win the prizes, but then they brought the actors out who were in the video and then awarded them prizes. Have you ever seen that happen in a video game or not a video game, a game show before?
No, I mean, I thought, you know what I think it was personally, because it's a piss take of candid camera, which is very popular in the 70s. Yeah. But I was kind of wondering that, if Brian De Palma, okay, this is a small film. I mean, this is put out by American Artists or American International Pictures. And they were known for quite gory, you know, drive-in movies. They did all the Beach Party films and all, you know, all the Roger Cormans and stuff like this. So, and they were known to take films and for really cheap budgets and let them out and they would make large amounts of money. And I was kind of wondering that if Brian De Palma made this later, like, was it Century, you know, 20th Century Fox? In this game show sequence, would those people, would the panelists be like celebrities? Because, you know, like we used to get like Match Game, and it'd be like, oh, and maybe if they were.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought maybe if they, you know, they would have like, you know, I don't know, Buddy Hackett and Paul Lynn and, you know, on the panel sort of thing. And then maybe that would cause these people to like, you know, the participants would win or something. I mean, I can understand the guy being, I'm not quite sure why Margot Kidder's character, Dominique, would win anything because she was hired. Where the other guy, I can understand why he would win something because He wasn't hired. He's like,
right.
Two complimentary dinners to the African club, though. I mean, what a cheesy prize anyway, regardless. You know?
But what's cheesier is that's the fact that she wins the steak knives. He gets the room to the African room. And then she asks him to take her, why don't you take me out to dinner? I'm your prize.
You know? Yeah. And then rips his face off. Yeah.
It's just like, okay. Now, I found it's quite interesting. This is that I like the voyeurism thing that we do get to a simple fact that, you know, I think Brian De Palma kind of nails it in the head about, you know, when people are in high rises and they're right next to each other, that everyone knows what everyone else is doing.
Exactly. Exactly.
And I thought that was very, very well done in this simple fact, you know. And I love the way that Brian De Palma does a lot of foreshadowing in everything. There's a foreshadowing going on in every single scene in this film that's leading you to like, this is what's going to happen, and this is going to happen, and this is going to happen, and then it actually happens, which is actually a good Alfred Hitchcock trick. Alfred Hitchcock used to do that all the time.
Right.
So
I didn't really see what, I mean, I know it was, you would have thought with the both movies we did this time around, I would have figured out the theme, but you know, with the quick shots between Margot Kidder being in the couch bed, the rollaway bed, and you know, he brings her the birthday cake, and then, you know, that the knife incident happens, but then they switch to her being on the floor again in the bathroom, back in her negligee. Mm-hmm. You know, and so it went bad. I mean, I was just sitting there. I'm going, well, maybe she does have a sister. I mean, I was like going, because they switched it so quick. It's just like, well, how did she dress that quick and change her face back so quick? And, you know, I mean, that's why I was like, okay, well, I wasn't expecting that either, because I hadn't seen either film before. So
I do have to sit there and say that Brian De Palma does cut back on the erotic sexual encounter that we learned to have in almost everything we have after this fact, which is quite interesting, because we do get, you know, we do get the character she goes home with, and basically, you know, he kisses Dominique's character or Danielle's character, and, you know, gets a bit of the boob that, you know, that we come to love from Brian De Palma. but then it kind of pulls back, and then we go into the next morning, which is, I have to say, for a Brian De Palma film, that's a bit, normally we would kind of get more of a sex scene, which was quite interesting.
Oh, yeah.
That we didn't get that.
Compared to Dress to Kill.
Yeah.
Kind of, sort of. It was kind of.
And I also found interesting in this film is that, I mean, a lot of people think that Brian De Palma was misogynist, and I don't think he was a misogynist, because all his female characters are very, very strong. Some female characters do die through violence, but it's always the female character that's the one he's putting together and is the strongest. But I don't think he was misogynist, and women who have worked with him have never said that he was misogynist. This is more about what Hollywood critics has labeled him, or newspaper people trying to make a name for themselves with.
But basically, back in the, I mean, this wasn't far off the mark how things were, though. I mean,
Not really, because I mean, if you look at it, okay, none of the women in this film are housewives. The only
women were coming into their own at that time.
Yeah, but what's quite interesting about this film is that every single woman, except for one, which is Jennifer Salt's mother,
right.
Which is quite interesting, because Jennifer Grace Collier, her mom is actually played by her real mother.
Oh, wow. So,
oh, wow. I didn't know that.
Well, she's an actress, and Brian De Palma loved playing daughter and mothers together. Like, Amy Irving's mom in real life is the mom who played her in Carrie. That's a great, that's Amy Irving's real mother. And he liked to play these daughter and mother, because he said that when you put a mother and daughter on screen together and they're both actresses, they bring something more to the scene.
So Carrie's mother was Amy Irving's mother? Piper Laurie was her mother?
No. Amy Irving's character's mother was her mother in real life.
Okay. Gotcha. Okay.
Mary Davenport is Jennifer Salt's mother. Jennifer Salt. Okay. If you recognize her face, you probably recognize her from the TV series Soap. That's where Jennifer Salt ended up going after this. Mary Davenport, or her characters, you know, Pace and Collier. Grace's mom is the only woman that doesn't, we don't know if she has a career or not, but every other woman in this film has a career. You got Olympia Dukakis' character as the baker.
Right.
You got the two baker women. You have Danielle / Dominique. You know, she's a model. You got Grace. She wants to be an investigative reporter who has a habit of pissing off people that pissing off people
and
that
normally help her.
After she needs them, and then it becomes a problem. And which is quite interesting. And if you notice that most films, you know, we're looking at 1972, 73, and most films didn't have, every single woman character having a job, which is
great. Right.
You know, he was breaking all kinds of ground in every single direction he could in the 70s. You know, you watch, nobody was making the kinds of movies that he is. And the other thing, as we're sitting here trying to describe this movie, like, it's one of those crazy, you know, suspense films where you don't have a really linear plot. You go from, like, sort of a murder whodunit to a freaking, you know, a woman trapped in an insane asylum with a mad scientist, essentially.
Basically what it was.
Yeah, it's...
One thing I didn't understand, and seeing as you guys are more familiar with the film than I am, when they were in the asylum, when they took the Grace... Collier, the reporter. Mm-hmm. Why was she being kept in the same room with Danielle? Just to keep an eye on him, or was this just someone?
No, I think this has to be a simple fact. It's a part of the brain control, and able to.
I can answer that.
Okay, you can.
So what I believe De Palma was trying to do here again is talk about a couple of disparate events involving mind control. And the only way to really understand mind control is to look at what our government has been doing since World War II. What De Palma was doing was throwing a twin motif at us over and over again. The Nazi doctors who were brought over as part of Operation Paperclip, who were eventually subsumed into the MKUltra program, were obsessed with twins. They were obsessed with taking different sets of twins and separating them and sewing people together and doing all sorts of stuff. And I think that what De Palma was doing was showing us a very sort of Nazi-esque experiment being utilized by a doctor who was working at a place that was a fictional version of Willowbrook, where, again, we saw all sorts of horrific experimentation on human subjects, mind control, and he was using those images kind of... A lot of people saw pieces of these stories on the news, on what sort of news they were getting about it, and he was taking it and kind of doing a monster mash with it. So you saw evil doctor, twin, mind control, Staten Island, insane asylum. He was taking these very real elements and combining them into a story. But there was enough stuff in the background that people would look at and recognize in a culture.
Back in the day, though, I mean, things were not monitored at all well. Years ago, when I was like in my middle 20s, I started working at a place in upstate New York. It was they were home settings for people who were mentally handicapped that were released from like places like Saranac Lake and downstate places like that. A lot of them were mentally retarded and whatnot. And we had to put them in sort of like hostels. And you probably know what it is, Keith. It was called Jefferson Rehabilitation Center in Watertown.
ARC.
Yeah, I worked there for a long time. I really loved that job, actually. And a lot of these people came from places like that, and they had all kinds of things wrong with them. I won't go into any detail, but you could tell what these people who didn't have a voice at all, I mean, literally could not speak, that there was all kinds of horrendous things that probably happened to him in that period of history. And so when Geraldo came out with that, I remember exactly what you're talking about. I totally forgot about it. Did not make the connection to this movie, but you're spot on that. I would have never have thought of that had you not brought it up.
Well, yeah, it's the thing that made me think of it is I was sitting there. I'm from Long Island, and like, he could have filmed that movie anywhere. So why Staten Island? Like, honestly, like, really, why Staten Island? If you guys know, it's one of the most depressing places on earth. sorry, Staten Island. I love your pizza.
I do love your pizza.
but honestly, the only reason I can think of for him to do that is because that's exactly where Willowbrook was. And, you know, when you said Son of Sam, there's all sorts of stuff that got tied to it later on. Like, you ever heard of the Cropsey urban legends? That all popped out of there. And, yeah, Son of Sam did, and a lot of other really spooky stuff comes out of Staten Island and comes from the mental hospitals that were there. The thing with the twins and her being in there, I think he was kind of like intimating that the evil guy who looked straight up like, you know, if one of the boys from Brazil had survived, they would have looked like whatever Dr. Husband's name was. I can't remember.
Joseph Mengele.
I think that the intimation was he was going to try and sew them together at some point, because why not?
When they were born, this is one part, I've watched it twice and I still hadn't come to this whatever scenario in my mind. When they separated the girls as twins, why did the other sister die? Did she die later? Was it some kind of weird happenstance? Or was it because
the reason why they separated them anyway wasn't because they wanted to be separated. What happened is that because the Siamese twins have two, they have their own personalities.
Right.
And basically what happened is they had to separate them because one of them fell pregnant and the other twin was trying to abort it using a pair of garden shears.
Okay.
And so she became a danger to the other twins, so they separated. Now, normally, separation of Siamese twins, there is a really small chance that both of them will live. Because sometimes they share internal organs. Sometimes the blood supply is more shared than in some others. You know, the blood might be more of the blood might be going through one heart than both hearts and sort of thing like that. And so sometimes the separation, and we're looking at a late separation. We're not looking at babies being separated.
Right.
We don't know. And, you know, this is where Brian De Palma doesn't really go into the medical history of, you know, these people, but like maybe they shared a liver or maybe they share, you know, it's hard to
tell. Do you think one was necessary for one to die in order for the other to live, basically? Was that where he was going?
Well, the thing is, we know that they're joined at the hip, but we're not quite sure.
Right, they're conjoined.
But we're not quite sure how they're joined. Is it, you know, like sometimes, like, you know, they might share a spinal column,
right,
cause a problem. But we don't really know what internal organs. They might both have their own internal organs, and maybe she just died because of whatever. But we're not quite, he never really lets us know what, you know.
Okay, I was just wondering if I missed something.
No, you didn't really. It's just that she just happened to die. But it is a serious operation. It's not an easy operation. That's the reason why, you know, you got a pair of twins that they did a documentary on, that they graduated from school. They actually share a body, but there's two heads coming out of the body. Right. And they're living today. And, you know, I think the documentary I saw, they were basically learning how to drive, which would probably freak you out if you saw that coming down the street at you.
Oh, no shit.
but then there's the other pair of twins who, Siamese twins, they were American. One was shorter than the other, so she had to be on like a high chair, and she got wheeled around because the other sister was bigger, because the other sister would basically get most of the nutrition, so she developed faster than the smaller one, but they were joined to the forehead. The odd thing about those two is one was a nurse, and the other one, a nurse in ITU, so imagine waking up to that after a long surgery, and the other one was a country western singer, so figure that one out. But then you have, you know, the Siamese twins, like Ying and Yang. They both were married to two separate women, had lots and lots of kids. We have the famous Siamese twins that were in the movie Freaks, which is a classic film. Anyone that's...
The Todd Browning one?
Yeah, the Todd Browning Freaks is bloody fantastic. I'm just waiting for a good Blu-ray done, because some of the dialogue in the DVD or the video is a bit garbled. So it'd be nice to see if they can clear up some of the...
What year was that movie?
1936, maybe.
Freaks.
Fantastic film. It ruined Todd Browning's career. But the Siamese girls in there is that one of them was married, the other one wasn't. And there,
I wonder how that works, you know? Talk about give and take, literally.
Well, you just kind of figure it's like, you know, can you just imagine? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that really does boggle. I'm too amorous, so I'm not. You know, and I thought that was another interesting thing, which we did cover in the others, but now we're going, you know, now we're doing with Siamese twins in this one. And of course, we'll be covering the theme with Goodnight Mommy later on. But it's the death of a twin. But imagine now twins, you know, you spend every single waking day, you share a womb together, and you spend every single waking day together. And then one dies. Now picture your Siamese twins and one dies. What kind of mental breakdowns are you going to have there? And
they do say there's some kind of psychic connection. There have been studies, you know.
It's just, yeah, oh, absolutely. Like, I think of, you guys ever heard of Alan Watts?
I believe no.
Okay, so Alan Watts is a writer. Anyway, he's just a really interesting guy. But one of the things he talks about is how the human body, you know, ostensibly ends at your skin. But if you take a human and then separate him from the rest of his environment, he'll die depending on how much of his environment you separated from all the quicker. You know, so like if you separate him from food, he'll die within, I don't know, 2 weeks or a week or whatever.
Right.
Food and water, it goes up to like a few days. Food, water, and air, a few seconds. So how much of the environment is also part of what you are. So if you're a twin and you've literally breathed the same air and, you know, metabolized the same food, when that person dies, a piece of you dies, you know. That's just, there's no getting around it, you know.
Right.
I had to sit there and say that I would hate to be a Siamese twin. I mean,
I would not want to be your Siamese twin. I can't imagine being joined at the hip with your ass.
But the whole thing is like, I mean, you know, okay. I mean, the physicalness of it. Yeah. Okay. There's going to be lots of problems with that. But the idea, think of the mental side of this. You're joined to someone that you're never going to be get away from. And you have your own personality and they have their own personality. And you're stuck with each other no matter what you do for the rest of your life until the day you die. You're with this person. And knowing my luck, I would hate the person I'm stuck to. And can you imagine? And you know, like when brothers and sisters are growing up, and we've all done it, where you have fist fights with each other.
Right.
Now, you're joined to them while you're fighting them. And then you get the other stories about what happens when Siamese twins die. They don't die at the same day. Sometimes they'll die, and the other one will die 3 or 4 weeks later, and they're carrying their dead twin around with them.
Yep.
Picture that.
How does that? I never even thought of that. I mean, is the blood still circulating through their body, and they're just brain dead? I mean, is that how it works?
Well, it depends on organs and what if they have their own organs and they're not sharing any organs, then the other person's deteriorating on them while they're.
I never thought of that. How horrendous.
So, I mean, if you look at some of the medical implications of what it means to be Siamese and stuff like this, I mean, they do die, you know, within weeks of each other, but still weeks.
Yeah.
You know? And I mean, we just had a bank holiday here and I've only worked 4 days this week because of the bank holiday. And I'd say this is the longest week of my life. So imagine you got you know, time is relative. You know what I mean? There's sometimes it's like you look back, like time's gone really quickly,
right.
And there are other times that time has just gone to a standstill. That just so I mean, yeah. Now I also think what's quite interesting about this film as well is that we do get Grace the wannabe detective, which is something that we do get in a lot of Brian De Palma films, which we also get a lot of in Alfred Hitchcock, the common man, you know, investigating a murder, which when we do next episode, we're going to be doing Stage Fright with Alfred Hitchcock. And there's going to be a lot of this theme that will be going carried on in that film as well. But we get the amateur sleuth solving the crime. And that's what we get with Grace here. And then we start, what we do is at first we get this is where I think is quite interesting about this Brian, you know, sisters, is that we start out with a third person or watching everything through a third eye sort of thing. And then once Grace enters the picture, now we get everything from Grace's side of the story. And we learn everything as Grace is knowing it and as Grace is piecing things together. And now all we got, so we've gone from a third, you know, third person narrative to now to almost a one person's narrative, which I thought he did that very seamlessly. You're not really aware that this is what's happening.
No.
And he does this in a certain way where he does it through split screen.
Right.
So basically what happens is we get the murder that takes place. We get Grace looking at it, you know, seeing what's happening. And you see basically her newspaper clippings coming across the left-hand side of the screen while what's going on in the right-hand screen is what's going on in Danielle's appointment. And then we get the whole split screen. And then as you notice, when the split screen stops, all of a sudden now we're in Grace's world. And I thought that was very, very clever.
Yeah,
you kind of feel sorry for Grace, though, because she was sitting there trying to prove a point, you know, especially when they figured out that the body was rolled up into the couch. I mean, how ingenious is that to stuff a body in a rollaway couch? Mm-hmm. You know, the lover that came home with her the night, the man from the game show. But on top of that, though, she probably would have had a better chance at everything if she wouldn't have talked smack about the cops so much than in her newspaper articles. So she was like screwed from the beginning, actually.
Well, I mean, that's the thing with political activists sort of thing. They'll like screaming from the rooftops. And then when right. they need them, all of a sudden it's like, you know,
yep.
sort of thing. And that's, and then I guess
she's also, she was not investigating very smartly. Like that show would have come out sooner or later. And if the guy was dead, like once that happens, it's, hey, don't follow people into a mental hospital. You can just kind of let the machinery take over once that guy didn't exist in a vacuum, you know?
Yeah. They didn't have the technology back then. Like, I mean, they had skill sets. We know that. I mean, they did catch people like Son of Sam and stuff like that eventually. But I mean, you didn't have DNA. You didn't have the internet. I mean, think of all this new technology where you can't really do shit no more because they're going to catch you if you spit on the sidewalk in downtown Dallas, you know? I mean, you can't get away with nothing anymore.
I mean, another thing with Grace, though, I mean, we have a character who's quite, even though she's a strong-willed woman with a fault. She doesn't really listen to those around her. And the thing is, we do get a bit of this when, you know, the conversation that she's having with her mom. And her mom's going, oh, your little job and stuff like this. And she's kind of very dismissive of everyone around her because she thinks she's always right. She thinks she knows everything. And then we get the fantastic scenes with Charles Durning, and my hat's off to Charles Durning. Anytime he appears in anything, you know you're in first-rate film because he's bloody fucking fantastic. And, you know, he's like, no, I'm the professional. I've taken courses in this. I know what I'm doing. And she's like, no, we need to do it this way. No, we need to do it this way. The simple fact that, you know, even with the cops, and the cops are going in and talking to Danielle after the murder sequence, you know, and she's just right in there like, you know, like a bull in a china store. And which creates, but at the end of the day, this is what creates a downfall. And you're getting all this is how Grace is dealing with every social circumstances that she's in. So that when this does, you know, when her downfall basically does happen, you know, she does get to live through it, but it does create her downfall. It's because of her own obtuse way of dealing with things.
She knows how Charles Durning, the sign on top of his van changed every so often from pest control to window cleaning.
I have to sit there and say that the way this film ends, and I think this is fantastic, is Charles Durning following the sofa, where the sofa's going to go, where this body's going to go, and then the final scene is him at the Canadian border on a telephone pole, watching the pole. Who's going to pick up the sofa. Pure genius.
There's a cow there and a tractor.
So good.
But going back to hiding the body in the sofa, I've had pull away sofas before,
right?
And I'm how they got that body in and was put that thing straight and put it down.
Yeah,
I mean that's a pure genius. I don't know how they did that.
I mean, I had a hard enough time rolling blankets and stuff in our rollaways, and we had them. Just like I couldn't even get the blanket packed in there. Yeah. You know,
that's like a big duvet. It's like forget it. It's like and then if you did get it in, like the bottom would be like down further, and the top would still be up, and then you put the cushions on it. So basically everyone's sitting up with their knees in their face.
And it was a white couch, okay? And there was blood everywhere. And then they cleaned up that blood. How long do you think? He had cleanser. He was cleaning the floor. You know, Dr. Mengele, that's what I'm going to call him. You know, he was, I mean, he got all, except for that one part on the back of the couch, there was still blood there. But I mean, it was, everything was white in that apartment. It just like.
Yeah, but you know, I think this is back off the 1970s cleaning products because he did clean it with, remember that green cleaning product that we had in the 70s that was in that green drum. I can't even remember the name of it.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. I can't remember.
You know, thing that it would burn your skin off if you touched it with your hands.
It was caustic. Yeah, it was caustic.
And he was cleaning everything in that fire with that stuff. Nothing lived in that. I'm surprised that you haven't eaten your floorboard, that stuff would.
I forgot. I'm going to have to try to find out what that is. I remember exactly what that stuff was, too. We had it in our house.
Oh, God. My mom had all that sort of stuff. I remember, like, the bleach was a lot stronger when we were growing up because
right.
a friend of mine burnt themselves on bleach when they were a little kid. They spilled some bleach on them, and they had, like, second-degree burns from the bleach.
Yeah.
I mean, nowadays, I mean, you can pretty much bathe in bleach, and you'll be fine.
Right.
Like those. Everything was very caustic and strong.
No wonder we all have problems all these years later, you know?
Well, but then again, we were a lot healthier at the same time, so it's kind of weird.
Yeah, we were.
Now, I think another thing that once we get Grace into the mental institution and stuff like this, I love the dream sequences that we do get here. And we always get dream sequences in every Brian De Palma. We got Dressed to Kill opens with a dream sequence. We have the Carrie at the end, that's a dream sequence. We have, you know, we get in Body Double, Blowout, we get dream sequences. We get, you know, in every single, and this is a trope of Brian De Palma's. But this one, I think he does it a bit differently because this time the dream sequence is not there to shock or like to remind us that we're watching a film and this isn't reality. But he does it to actually give us a lot of information. And I thought that was quite cleverly done in this.
Right.
Now, it's also interesting to know that in this dream sequences that what he's showing you is real circus freaks of the time. There's Lobster Boy. He's in there.
Yeah.
And his daughter. She's in there as well. Lobster Boy would become famous in the 90s is that he married. I think his name was Will Groen or something like this, but I'm not quite sure on that what his real name was. But Lobster Boy was this very, very famous boy. And basically he was born with his fingers were fused together, giving the impression he was a lobster. So they called him Lobster Boy in the circuit. Then what happens is that when America vetoed and got rid of the freak shows, as they were called at that time, it right. left him out of work. So he became an alcoholic. But another thing that he did, he loved his deformity and was quite good with his, he's very happy with his deformity to the point that he didn't want any kids unless they shared his deformity. So basically what his idea was before the freak shows closed, that he was going to have his own family of lobster people sort of thing. And so he married a woman who had the same, same infliction, and they had a bunch of lobster children. And then what happens is that when they became unemployed due to Americans not feeling very comfortable with the freak show and said that these people were being exploited, he became an alcoholic to the point where he became abusive, and eventually his family had to kill him in real life.
Well, he was killing people too, I believe.
So, well, he, you know, is an alcoholic sort of thing. And, you know, I mean, there are questions that have never been proven whether that if they had any normally, in quotations, formed children that did they kill those children because they weren't deformed? There's that question, but it's never proven. So
then he shows up in American Horror Story many years later.
Well, that was
circus. That was probably the freakiest freaking American Horror Story ever, especially with Doogie Howser in there. Doogie Howser banging the Siamese twins just about killed me. That was my undoing, just saying.
In 1966, there was an article in Life magazine about the lives of the Soviet Siamese twins, Marcia and Dasha Kravalopova, and I'm sure I mispronounced
good enough, good enough.
You're Russian, I'm sorry that I just killed your
name. Say it.
Dialect. Krisalanopova? Krisalanopova? Anyway, so basically this is where the idea of this comes through. So when they do show pictures of the Siamese twins in this film, in the dream sequences, and in the documentary film that Bernard Hughes shows. Bernard Hughes plays Arthur McLennan, the original person who wrote the article based on Danielle in the film. But the actual pictures of the Siamese twins are actual Siamese twins as well. So all the people that you see in the mental institution are real circus freaks who
actual.
Were part of the freak show exhibitions at that time, which I thought that was quite well done. And I love the way that when Bernard Hughes shows the film about the history of Danielle, I love the way that was all put together as well.
Right. Yeah, that was well done.
Though I do wonder, it's like, how did he was able to show that? Because this is before video. It's like, oh, can I show you this film? It's like, I can just imagine those days. Like, let me show you this film. And you get out the projector, pull up the sheet, turn out, shut down all the lights, throw the curtains so you can show a film. But yeah. So, but besides that, was there anything you'd like to add about Sisters, Vicky?
I thought it was probably one of the freakier movies I'd seen. Then again, every time I haven't seen something, you or John or whoever, or you suggest I haven't seen, and I'm traumatized for at least a week or two until the next movie. I thought it was really beautifully done, though. Margot Kidder, she's always been one of my favorites. I thought she did fantastic in this movie. And, you know he did his job, De Palma did, because you're uncomfortable probably throughout most of the movie. And if you're uncomfortable, then you know he did his job properly. So it was a great, I would highly suggest it. It's a great movie.
And what about yourself, Will? Have anything to add about Sisters?
Oh, just a Margot Kidder was just a national treasure. She's gone. But also, I thought it was really interesting. So, if you remember, the last movie that we talked about on the last show was Inside, the French film.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so, both Inside and Sisters, the opening murder. Or I guess the opening injury is a stab wound to the same part of the face. If you remember, what's the?
I'm trying to remember now.
Takes the butcher knife. Yeah. To the same part of the face. It's the same exact. I had to go back because I've got both movies now. Right. I had to go back and look, but it's the exact same injury. I thought it was to do that.
Oh, that's quite interesting, actually. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. I actually have to add also, isn't it interesting that the men, when they are killed, are always stabbed through their groins?
Yeah, or their femoral artery or something like that. There's a lot down there to bleed out on, basically.
Well, because of that, some of the scholars who have actually looked at this film over the years says one can define the monster of Sisters as women's liberation.
Depending on which version of women's liberation, if you're talking then, probably not. Now, yeah, maybe.
You know, they did do a remake of this in 2006.
I saw that.
Stephen Ray and Chloe Sevigny.
I didn't watch it, though.
I can imagine it's going to be pretty horrible, but I haven't seen it, so I'm
just. I just don't like redos. I think some things they just should not redo, that's all.
I never even knew there was a remake.
I saw that in the research that there was a remake.
Yeah. So anything more you want to add about Sisters, Will?
No, just that it's great. Everyone should go watch it.
And for me, Sisters is, I'm a huge Brian De Palma fan, and one of my favorite films of his is Obsession, and I can watch his films over and over and over again. And Sisters, it's fantastic. It's one of those films that the first time I saw it, I thought it was kind of weird and strange. But every time I see it, it becomes less strange, because more fantastic sort of thing. And I mean, I love Sisters. I think it's, I love the visual style of it. I love the way it unfolds. I love the slow burn of it. I love the violent tendencies that happen in it. And I love, everything, even to the ending. I think it's, I can't find any fault with Sisters. So I highly recommend it. So this brings us to our next film, Goodnight Mommy, the 2014 Austrian film. That was directed by Veronika, Franz, and Severin, Fiala. I'm sure I mispronounced that one as well.
You butchered it.
I'm pretty sure I did. It was
Fiala, Severin, Fiala.
It was the Austrian entry for the best foreign language film of the 88th Academy Awards, though it was not nominated because apparently the Academy didn't really like the subject matter in this film. They probably were offended like they are with most things. Before we go into discussion of it, Vicky, do you have anything about the making of it? Because I have nada.
I don't have nada on it. I just know that it was, you always do this to me. When you don't get nada, you put me under the gun. Listeners, I'm telling you, it doesn't really say much about it. This, the cinematography was, I'm not even going to try to say it, Martin Geschlacht. It was edited by Michael Palm. Production company was Ulrich Seidel. Company was Film Production GmbH, and it was distributed by Radius TWC. But they, and the release date was August 30th of 2014. Running time is 100 minutes. And it was in German. Box office, it grossed $2.2
million. And what about yourself, Bill?
He's got nothing, Will.
Got nada.
It's a very mysterious movie, I think, almost by design. Like, you don't know a whole lot about Veronika Franz, who's the woman who...
The mother.
Yeah. Well, no, Veronika
Franz... No, the director. Director.
Yeah. I don't know if the... we're all scrambling now. It's funny.
People will have great laughter at our expense, so it's okay. Yeah.
You know,
I'm thinking of the cast. You know, none of the cast has really been in a whole lot of other movies. I think that that's all by design.
I've not recognized any of these people. I mean, the boys, they were kind of, they're a handsome set of twins. I mean, they're, or was it just?
Well, I think that that's not by an accident. And this reminds me a lot of another German horror movie called Funny Games.
Yeah,
which, there's an American
Funny Games.
Yeah. And if you notice, they did a lot of the same thing around that movie. Those two actors, I don't think, appeared in a whole lot after that. And they certainly weren't famous before. So when you were watching it, it adds to that overall creep factor. You're kind of, you don't really know what's going on. It's a great movie. I mean, it's really uncomfortable to watch this one I'm talking about. Actually, both Funny Games and this are great movies that are really uncomfortable to watch, I guess.
Most of this movie, though, I didn't see half of this coming. I didn't see half of it coming.
No, you know, it's you don't know what you're... This is a supernatural movie that plays out where nothing supernatural happens until the end, and then you realize it's all been supernatural as Get Out, and it questions everything that you've seen. I watched it for the second time now. I've only ever seen it once before, and the funny thing is, you know, we can talk about the twist right away. Is that cool?
I think the best thing to do at the moment, I think we're going to cut to a commercial break and cut to the trailer.
Okay.
And we'll be right back after these messages.
Hello?
What's your favorite scary movie?
I have a bunch of favorite movies. I watch them all on Shudder.com for only $4.99 a month.
That's a scary low price.
But if I had to pick a favorite, it'd probably be Scream.
Oh.
Yeah, it's the only streaming service that lets me watch hundreds of horror movies on demand.
I'll be right back.
Hello? Hello? Hello, are you gonna subscribe? Hello?
Go to Shudder.com to subscribe, if you dare.
Du bist nicht unsere Mama. Bitte komm zurück, Mama. Ich mach alles. Jetzt kann sie uns nicht mehr auseinanderhalten.
Guten Abend, gute Nacht.
Hello, welcome back to Literary License Podcast. And now we're discussing the 2014 Austrian classic, Goodnight Mommy. So, Vicky, do you want to give a quick synopsis of the film?
Yeah, well, this film was written and directed by Veronika, Franz, and Severin, Fiala. It was also selected as an Austrian entry for Best Foreign Language Film in the 88th Academy Awards, though it was not nominated. And it's about two twin boys who move to a new home with their mother after she's faced a drastic, probably changing cosmetic surgery. But under her bandages, there is someone the children feel they do not recognize. And there goes the story just takes off from there.
So, Will, what do you have to say about Goodnight Mommy?
Goodnight Mommy is directed by Veronika, Franz, who's made a couple of interesting movies. I couldn't click on what she had done right away. So she did an anthology movie called The Field Guide to Evil, which was kind of interesting with a lot of other European directors. And then she did a Jesus documentary, I'm pretty sure, way back when, which is just kind of an interesting thing to go from there to this really intense horror movie.
What a scope.
Yeah. So, and she's again, this is, I'm picking this up third hand now. I'm falling into Veronika Friend's rabbit hole. It looks like a lot of her movies have kind of a religious bent to them. But then this one right in the middle of it, which she directed with another woman named, I lost it.
Severin, that's all right. We lose it all the time.
Severin Fiala. But I don't really know. I know even less about her. But again, I was talking about Funny Games earlier and just how much the two movies kind of, remind me of each other. This is very good. I think it's, like I said, it's shot supernaturally, but then there's this sort of hyper-realistic plot that you think you're kind of working your way through until the very end.
Kind of reminded me of The Other.
Oh, yes, I could see that. Yeah.
Yeah. It has the two twin boys, and then what we also have is the twist at the end sort of thing. So yeah, they do,
right.
They do share a lot of similarities sort of thing.
Yeah. It's also very clearly a movie in three acts. You've got, the opening sort of builds where everything's just moody and atmospheric. And then, things sort of turn into a almost like a whodunit. And then it just gets very intense towards the third act.
Wasn't it like idyllic in the beginning? You got two boys outside playing. They're like doing their
beautiful,
Sawyer kind of thing, like boys will do when they're together, especially if they're siblings.
Yeah.
And it just looks all Pollyanna and Sunnybrook Farm, and then it just takes that nasty turn. I was texting Keith while I was watching it. I go, oh my God, there's giant cockroaches, because I'm terrified of cockroaches. And then he goes, cockroaches isn't the worst of it. Just keep watching.
No, and one of the things I still wonder about is what the hell was that place with all the human bones in it?
Yeah, it looked like this was in Austria where they filmed it, and I know that as an archaeologist, I know that they had ossuaries where bones were collected, but I didn't know that's what that was.
It looked like a ritual temple or something that they were going down into, and then it's the one thing that it's one of those sort of asides that happens in the movie where you're just like, well, what's going on? Like, where are they? It could have been on another planet. Like, honestly, if those bugs started talking to them halfway through the movie,
I would have been surprised. I don't even know. They couldn't pay me enough to work with insects like that. There isn't enough booze. There's not enough sedatives. There's just not enough horse tranquilizer. They're just nothing. There ain't nothing they could make me do to play with big cockroaches like that. Just nothing. That was like making me squirm. I hate cockroaches.
Really interesting because you live in Texas where the bugs are all the size of dinner plates.
And when one of them comes in the house, whether I'm in the shower or something else, I will scream and somebody will, I mean, I've actually felt like putting an ad in Craigslist. I go, I'll give $20 to whoever comes over to my house right now and kills this motherfucker. I mean, it's like, they're just huge. And I mean, they're not like that, but they're just big. And some of them have wings. And those are the ones that just going to put me in an early grave. I'm just terrified of them. I hate them things.
I mean, the problem, I think Goodnight Mommy, there's not a problem with the film per se, but I think the situation with Goodnight Mommy, that it doesn't give you any clear answers to anything.
No.
First of all, we do not know what happened. We don't understand what happened to Lucas at all. We don't know. And then why did the mother need plastic surgery?
But there was an accident. Remember she mentioned an accident to the priest?
But we're not quite sure what that accident is. We don't know. I mean, was it a car crash situation? That's why she needed it. Did it kill Lucas? Where's the father? Is there a father somewhere? Yeah. Is she divorced? You know, it's an interesting film because you kind of watch it, and it's one of those films that out of all horror films and most of the ones that we've covered, or dark fiction, if you want to call this a particular interval, is that this is probably one of the most beautifully shot films that you'll see.
It is. Exactly. I totally agree with that.
And, you know, but the thing is that it doesn't give us a lot of answers. It's like, we're expected to, it's almost like you're coming into the middle of a situation and no one's going to explain what the hell is going on. And you kind of have to go with it. Like, as you were saying with that cave with the body parts. I mean, what is that? Them walking on that clay and it's all kind of bouncy and springy.
I was just sitting there thinking about, man, one of those kids is going to fall in there. It's sort of like dried quicksand on top or something geologically. Mm-hmm. And just like, one of these kids is going to fall in there. You know, I mean, this is nothing but a movie full of questions, but it is beautifully shot, like you said. But I mean, I had a lot of questions. I thought you guys knew and you don't know either. So,
but another thing is was there a car accident? We're assuming that there was an accident, but maybe, I mean, if you want to take things into another direction, we do have the scene of Lucas floating on a raft in the water. Elias floating on a raft in the water. Lucas dives in, but he doesn't come back up. So maybe Lucas died in a drowning accident. Because, I know that we can sit there and go, maybe it was a car accident. But then if you think about it, the mother, as far as the cosmic surgery is concerned, by the pictures on the wall, this is something that she was planning for. So if it was a car accident situation, you wouldn't be planning for cosmetic surgery. You would have to, it just happens.
The synopsis does say that the woman tells Elias that Lucas has died in an accident prior to her return home. So she wasn't home when he died.
Precisely. So maybe we have a bit of symbolism on the raft scene, and maybe the scene with where all the bodies are, where all the skeletons, maybe that's a symbolism for the fact that every family has skeletons in their closets. Maybe.
That could be. True. I watched it once when it first came out, and then I watched it just before, doing this show. And two things kind of jumped out at me. One, like the constant reminder of that she was like some kind of a celebrity at some point makes me wonder if it was some sort of plastic surgery that she was just gotten a bunch of cosmetic surgery done because she's a TV personality or something like that.
She's a person of notoriety for sure.
Right. And then the other thing is there's that one really intense scene where she's been tied up and her half of her fucking face is glued together. And
they glued her lips together with super glue. Like, oh man, they're going to super glue her lips together. It's like, no.
But then the twins are wrestling. But while they're wrestling, the one twin has his hand over the other's mouth and nose.
Mouth and nose, yeah.
And so it leads me to wonder if he had some sort of smothering fetish, and that's what happened to his brother, and that's what also happened to, when he's like constantly trying to cover her mouth and nose, maybe that's just his thing,
Right. I mean, there were several instances with the water and the hand. I mean, you really don't know. I mean, it was a really mysterious film.
Well, actually, you can also take another look at this because the mother was definitely afraid of fire. So maybe, and again, remember that Elias is very, he seems very inept with a, not inept, but very skilled with a lighter and with fire. So maybe, yeah, maybe it was a fire accident, and maybe, you know, Elias or Lucas started a fire that one of them got killed, and this could have scarred the mother as well, because then that would bring the film full circle by the ending, that we get this, you know, get this fire sequences as well. But I mean,
yeah,
but I guess we're dealing, I mean, we are dealing with an art film, I think, as well. I mean, we're not dealing with like your normal run of the mill, you know, psychological thriller horror.
No, it doesn't owe you it's like a Lucio Fulci film, you know. Yeah. You're swept into the atmosphere of it, but it doesn't owe you a linear beginning, middle, and end. Mm-hmm.
Well, what happened to the cat? Okay, did any of you guys figure out what happened to the cat?
The thing is, the cat could have been a couple of things. I mean, I've seen this. This is about the third time I've seen this film. The first time I watched it, I was like, oh my god, I had to watch it again because I couldn't make sense of it. I mean, you know, it's just certain things I was looking for answers. So the third time, mm-hmm, things became slightly a bit more clear as far as the cat is concerned. And I think the cat was old. It was kind of, we don't know if it was diseased or not, but it was locked up in the place where all the dead bones are. They bring the cat there. And if you notice, the cat is very docile. It's kind of like sitting there. It's not moving. It's not anything like that. So it could have been old age. It could have been anything. And I know that they think maybe the mother killed the cat, but I think the cat probably just died. That's my impression is. Like, you know, this is my interpretation.
So. Yeah, well, I think that they think that she kills the cat. I don't know if she killed anything. She's certainly, you know, not the most warm-hearted lady on earth, but this is Germany we're talking about. Whatever. Like, she definitely may have drowned or killed the cat. I don't think she did, though. I also don't think she should have been drowning her kid's bugs, though, at any point either. It's probably not a good idea to drown anything to settle a family argument.
You can't drown a cockroach, trust me. I've tried to flame. You can't drown a cockroach. Those things are indestructible. So,
So maybe she knew what she was doing all along.
I mean, what we also have is, I mean, you mentioned the others, which we did cover on last week's episode. But you do also have the simple fact that I think we have a mother who, after the death of one of her boys, and we have, you know, this is kind of mirrors what happens in the other with the grandmother, is that it's almost like a game that, okay, you can keep Lucas alive because this is the way that you're going to deal with his death. And then it gets to the point, like, you can't do this anymore. He's dead. So I'm going to pretend this game never even started. But you can tell that in the movie at some point the mother, you know, let this happen. She was okay to play along with this game. Then something happened, and when she comes back with her new face, or maybe the surgery, maybe she thought new face, new life, new beginnings. I'm not quite sure. But, you know, then we get this thing where she changes on, you know, which creates, you know, pretty much creates her demise. The simple fact that she's allowed this game to happen where Elias can believe that Lucas is alive, and she's okay with believing this, but now she's no longer going to do this, and she's going to be she's going to treat Lucas like he's dead, and just treat Elias like he's one boy now, which is quite interesting in the film, because what we get, and I don't know if this is successful in the film or not, but we get a mother that looks like she's really cruel to one child.
Yeah. That's what I was thinking.
Go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say, because I was confused, because when she went out in the woods and she was taking her clothes off and she was going out into the woods, and then you know how Shudder does that thing with their shutter, she started doing that with her head, blah, 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 back and forth, and I go, oh, maybe she's an alien, you know. So I was kind of confused there for a while.
That wouldn't surprise me either with this movie.
I mean, another thing is that we do have the boys not thinking that the mother is their mother. And maybe the mother, I mean, you know, I think it's a film about miscommunication anyway. You know,
huge miscommunication.
But I mean, the thing is maybe the reason why, you know, the boys think this way is because, first of all, you know, they get a mother who's wrestling with a divorce or the death of her marriage. We're not sure where the father is here. The death of one of her children and a life-altering surgery. So, and at the same time, you know, you got this boy who believes that his brother's alive. And so basically, you know, and it's almost like the strangers moved in. And we do have hints hints in here that the mother used to be quite a kind mother. I mean, she's playing games, you know, the one with the head, who am I, what am I, favorite songs, which I think is quite fantastic that this film opens up with the original Maria Van Trapp and the Van Trapp family singing.
Oh, I know.
It's like, okay. And here we go down the rabbit hole. We're going outside of the Sound of Music now. But then what's also interesting about that Maria Van Trapp is that, and then maybe this is, you know, some more symbolism that the director's trying to put across, but we have Maria Van Trapp, and of course, in American's heart and all over the world, this Maria Van Trapp is Julie Andrews in The Sound of Music.
Right.
But now, if you've read any information about Maria Van Trapp, she wasn't a kind woman. She wasn't the nicest person. She betrayed the womanly, human thing. She took in the Van Trapp children and became, you know, the universal mother.
But oh, really? She was a monster, huh?
She apparently was like not a super monster, but she was very, very strict. She was very, very, you know, controlling. She was, you know, she wasn't the do-re-mi, you know, ride our bikes and, you know, had picnics on, you know, on the mountainside, you know, or running, you know, running around with her hands, you know, going through. And, you know, she probably was more like Mother Superior than she was Julie Andrews, apparently.
Right. Yes.
Which may, you know, but then being Austrian, and this is an Austrian film, they would know more about this Maria Van Trapp. So maybe that Maria Van Trapp thing in the beginning is, you know, is giving us a bit more information that we, you know, the Western filmgoer is probably not picking up on.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, there's also, you know, there's also things, I mean, there's a lot of strange things in here that you can read into. It's like, you know, like, you know, we have this thing about the favorite song that the mother can't remember, you know, the key moment that could have saved her life. And we have things about body language and unspoken actions. And
can we talk about the Red Cross for a minute?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What the hell was that? Does the Red Cross behave like that in Europe? Is that a thing?
I don't think so. I've never seen them come door to door here.
Well, I've never actually just had them walk into my house and ask me. Oh, maybe this is an Austrian thing. I don't know, but I was like, huh?
Like that started to happen and it reminded me just, it was kind of a nice little David Lynchian touch, but it was also, maybe that's just how they roll in Austria.
I don't know. I think they got a set of, things that their protocols. I think that's straight across the board. That was just weird. And anyway, no one takes money from children. Yeah. Okay. Either way, they wouldn't have taken the money.
Well, 50 euros. I mean, that's a lot.
Yes, it is.
Is your mother okay with this? Yeah, she's fine. It's like, and the thing, this is a question, like your mom's not home, but your mom's left her purse behind with 50 euros.
Yeah. Right.
And then, I mean, I guess the mother, not the mother, but the old woman, the Red Cross woman, she's a bit more astute than the man. The man's like, oh, well, obviously they're okay with it. Let's forget it. Let's take the money and run.
Take the money.
That was funny.
But, I mean.
Yeah, so again, one of those, you talk about the otherworldliness of this movie. It was just, there was things going on that just shouldn't happen. And so, it leaves you guessing all the way through in a very interesting way.
Well, I'm still guessing. I was kind of hoping you two guys would shed some light on it for me because I was like, okay. And the thing is, there's really not a lot of research on this movie. It's just one of those movies you have to watch and you take from it what it is you're going to take from it because there is no wrong or right opinion.
I mean, I watching it for me, I think the real tragedy is how each of the characters have an inability to cope with the grief that destroys your life. Mm-hmm. I mean, Elias wants nothing more than to have his family to be whole again with the loss of his father and brother. And then we have the additional loss of the mother is something that his mind can't really handle. And so, and because the mother comes back as like a different person, but then you got the mother dealing with her grief. So she's not the same person as she was before Lucas died or whatever happened.
Right.
And so we just got a picture of these people just, you know,
struggling.
Elias wants his family to be whole again. You got the mother who's dealing with the loss of her son. And, you know, I guess, you know, as you say before, with her marriage,
possibly
like this, there's the abandonment issues. And another thing is like the mother's going off having her surgery. Who's taking care of Elias? We don't
right. That's
know.
That's the other unanswered question of all of this.
And what's the deal with a guy bringing all the food to put it in the freezer with all the pepperoni pizza and all the stuff?
Yeah, but that's just, you know, that's the grocery delivery people. I mean, we have those here. I mean,
I know, but I mean, there was something supposed to be significant against the transaction.
Well, maybe she's just a mother who doesn't cook. Maybe she just heats up food. I don't know.
Yeah.
Or maybe it's a show that she's not.
Sounds pretty American to me.
Well, but I think maybe, you know, in Europe and as a whole, when it comes to families, not in England, but if you go in like Spain and Italy and France and Germany, and I'm assuming that Austrian follows suit, that families sit down together and the mother does cook a meal and the family sit down together and eat.
And that's
the norm here. I mean, the thing is like in Spain, it's like, you know, the reason why you have siestas is not because people can take a nap. They have siestas in Spain and in Italy for a simple fact.
Car crash.
Basically what happens is that everyone goes home for a big lunch. They sit down together and have a big lunch. They share information with each other. They share each other's day. They share each other's lives. And then they go back to work. And they do this. Yeah. They do this for 2 to 3 hours every day. Unfortunately, American cultures, we used to do that, you know, around dinner time. That no longer happens. But it's still very, very evident in Europe that just this is what they're carrying on, which probably means the reason why things are not as out of control as they are in Europe.
That's true. I did notice that in Europe and other countries last year that I was there, that everybody does sit down and everybody does take that rest in the afternoon.
So maybe, you know, showing the guy delivering the groceries and it's all like frozen pizzas and frozen meals and stuff like this, maybe this is show that this is not the kind of family or the kind of mother who takes a special interest in her family. Maybe, I mean, I'm clutching at straws here because
I was just wondering, well, they made such a big deal about the meal.
I think you're dead on. She seems very disconnected at that stage of the movie. And going back to what you were talking about with missed connections or miscommunications and stuff, like, that's communicated a lot through her face. So, like, in the beginning of the movie, she's portrayed as something almost like a monster. She looks crazy. There's that one scene where she, like, wakes up from a nap and just starts crunching whatever's in her mouth for no reason.
Yeah.
What was the deal with the cockroach going down her throat? Was that cockroach actually going down her throat?
I think it was a dream sequence because there's another dream sequence where he cuts her stomach open and they all come falling out.
Okay.
But, No. But also, like, the missed communication when she finally does take that rig off of her face and she has, like, 6 pounds of makeup on and looks crazy. They could have made her look completely normal when she has it off, but instead they have her sort of look even clownish, like, you know, with the bright red lipstick and all of the eye makeup on, to see her kids, you know, we're still thinking at that point. But I think that also we're willing to believe that she would starve out not Lucas. Is it Lucas? I forget which one's the...
Lucas.
Elias is the one that's live. Lucas is the
one. Okay, yeah. So I think that we're willing to accept at face value that a woman who looks like that would starve one of her kids, because there's a lot of shorthand in showing somebody that injured. You assume right away that she's on like 60 different kinds of painkillers, which causes parents to behave not all that great to their kids sometimes.
Right.
So they're doing a lot of communication through the images on screen, but then they screw with you by not making all those images always add up in a way. Is that?
Yeah. I mean, the mother is a product of her own demise, though. I mean,
for sure.
And the thing is, I mean, the mother could have, you know, if she was a bit more involved in Lucas, she's not involved at all. I mean, she's not the greatest person. She doesn't communicate with Lucas. She doesn't give him any warmth. There's no kind of like hugging him. There's no kind of emotional contact with him. She stands off to the side the whole time. She's almost, maybe Elias killed Lucas. Maybe that is it. And therefore,
well, Elias keeps telling Lucas, he goes, why don't you apologize to her? Remember he kept saying that? Why don't you apologize to her?
Well, and this is where I think we get like, the kind of a nod to the other. Because in the other, remember, we had the two twins. One was the kind one. The other one was the psychopath. sort of thing. And mm-hmm. of course, the psychopath dies by his own hands, which the empathetic one is the one that keeps him alive. And maybe that's a nod to here, where we got Elias is the empathetic one, and maybe Lucas was the psychopathic one.
Right.
But then again, you know, the other is a bit more well-rounded as far as it feeds you a lot more information than this does.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I mean, here we got quite a claustrophobic film with just three people in it, really. I mean, we got some people.
Oh, yeah.
We got like three characters.
Well, she always wanted the blinds drawn. She wanted total darkness, too, you know. Blinds were drawn. Don't make any noise. Knock on my door.
You know,
even in my most sickest moments, even when I'd like, I had major surgery and stuff, my kids needed me, even if they, I mean, I would just crawl out the door, but I mean, I wasn't, you know, I wasn't like that to where, you know, my kids needed me, they needed me, you know, so I was wondering what the hell was wrong with her the whole movie until I was like, oh, you know, when he started catching stuff on fire and everything else. And apparently I'm assuming that he died with his mother because at the end they looked like the Von Trapp family. Remember?
Right.
I think what we have also here is, I think this is where Veronika, Franz, and Severin, Fiala do a fantastic job. And the first time you don't get it, when you watch it the second and third time, or as many times you watch it afterwards.
Right.
They revealed the twist right away. The twist is there from the very, very beginning. And they do reveal this. And the thing is, when
explain
you watch
it,
when
it
you,
to me, because I think I missed it.
You see it all the way through. She does one glass for him and everything like that. It is there. And the
thing, okay. You
know, and it is there that there's only the one boy. And they reveal this like 10 minutes in the film, that this is what it is, sort of thing. And about the accident and all this other stuff. So it is there. So when you watch it a second time, you can tell that they kind of thing this. But the story is not based on the twist. There's not like an M. Night Shyamalala, whatever his name is, Shyamalala.
Right. Shyamalan.
You know, where it's like, you know, he tries to be so careful with his twist endings that you start the ceiling from a mile away. But this is not about the twist. This is about the important thing about this is about the characters and their story. And that's what's driving this forward. It's not like, okay, we're going to do this, so we're going to have this great big twist ending. Ta-da, this is Hollywood. I think the directors are a lot more clever than that with this film. And I think that's what makes the film really work. Is that all the answers are there. They're all there. It's just that you're going to have to do your own legwork here. You're going to have to come up with your own mental capacity about what's going on here. It's up to you, the viewer, to come up with your own answer, because I'm not going to give them to you.
Right.
And I think that's what makes Goodnight Mommy such a fantastic film, because we get this beautifully looking film and this beautiful landscape. All the they're giving you clues all the way through it, and they're not conclusive clues. You're the detective. You're the one who's going to put the story together. And by the end of it, it's up to you to put the story together, because I'm not going to explain this bitch to you. It's up to you to do it. You do the work. I made the movie. You're the audience. You do the work. And that's what I like about Goodnight Mommy. I think that's what makes it work.
Oh, I loved it. I wasn't expecting, like I said, so I was texting you, I go, okay, what's going on? You just keep watching, you know, and I'm just like, I don't know why I didn't expect the ending, because it was really right in front of you. I just didn't see it. And it's like, oh, smack, you know. And I thought she was just being a mean mother, and she wasn't feeding the other child or giving him a drink or anything. I thought she was just a bitch.
Well, the first time I watched it, I'm with you. That's what I thought the first time around. On the second and third. Mm-hmm. And that's what I think what's so magical about this film for me is that every time I see it, I see more and more. And I understand it a bit more. It's like watching a David Lynch film. But unlike Mulholland Drive, you don't get that eureka moment. Like, you walk away from it and you think you have it all figured out. And you're like, yeah, my God, I figured out. I am so bright. I'm so intelligent. Because after Mulholland Drive, you did feel that way. It's like, if you could work it out, you felt like, oh, I'm a bit superior. But with Goodnight Mommy, there's no right answers.
No.
Right.
And that's what I think is quite brilliant. The torture sequences are interesting. You know, who would have thought that such household items like surgical bandages and crazy glue and nail scissors could create so much damage.
I know they cut her mouth open so she could eat a pepperoni pizza after they'd super glued it together. It's just like, I'm going, I can't believe it. He's going to cut her lips open. Oh my God. It's like, no, you know, and I was like cringing, you know, and then taking the spyglass and burning her with the sun and stuff, like these mean little shits, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, on second viewing, when I saw the two of them come out with their little matching tool belts on, I was like, oh, I remember this now. This is going to get really rough. And boy, like, seeing two kids with matching, like, kid tool belts is creepy as hell now. Like, it's just the worst. All of those little tools that they were using, yeah, like you said, it's just, ugh.
You know what else is quite clever about this, and I noticed this time around, is that remember when they're torturing the mom, they got her tied up with whatever, and they go into the bathroom and they're having a fight with each other.
Right.
And did you notice that they both had bloody noses, but one was the mirror image?
Yes, I did notice that.
And I thought, okay, this is interesting. I mean, I know, first I was like, oh, how did they get both? I think the first time I watched this film, I kind of overthought things. Like, how did they both get bloody noses? How did that work out?
They're beating the shit out of each other.
Well, yeah, but one doesn't exist. So you're thinking, okay. But now with the mirror. Right. Then when I caught on, it took me to just my third watch that I actually caught on to this. So even though I might be bright when it came to Mulholland Drive, I wasn't that bright with this film. But then I realized it was a mirror image. So it's like, oh, okay.
Did you notice also that when he came out after that fight was over, he didn't have the bloody nose? And it makes me wonder, like, did he have it at all? Because honestly, how did he get it? Because was he wrestling with a ghost? Like, I don't know.
Or was it like one of those, you know, Fight Club moments where...
Sure, where he's Tyler
Durning in the office. But I mean, he wasn't saying sort of thing. I think... Going back to your cockroaches, I think cockroaches normally mean death and decay.
Yeah.
And I think that the whole thing with the cockroaches is decaying. And then I think the dream sequence for me is when they're like inside the body, is that the mother is dead inside.
Right. Mm.
And I think that's what it, you know, symbolizes. So I could be completely wrong, but I think that's how I look at it. And another thing, so then you have, because they put the cockroaches in with the dead cat as well at some point. And the cat's dead. And they do find the cat, and the cat's with decayed. It was all about decay. I guess
it was basically about death anyway.
Death, you know, and decay in relationships, I suppose. And
that too. I mean, there's all kinds of analogies you can draw to it. But like we all said, I mean, it's just one of those movies, like, it's your own conclusion at this point. But the Von Trapp family, that really was kind of, it was a little catchy in the beginning.
Yeah.
You know, I was wondering, I saw the Von Trapps, I go, what the hell is this going to be about?
I mean, I'd love to see what these people come up with next, really. I'm really interested to see what their next film's going to be. I mean, this came out...
They've got one coming out. Gosh darn it.
I just had it, too. I can't find it now.
Lost it. It looks like another witchy sort of slow-burning type movie. I can't find it now.
Oh, okay. Because I'm going to earmark that director, actually.
Yeah.
I said before, this is my third viewing of it. And every time I see it, I love it more and more. So, and I love it.
Oh, it's called The Lodge. I'm sorry. The Lodge. So she'll be coming out with that. And I think that's an English language movie, actually, but I might be mistaken.
She might be trying to appeal to a larger audience. A lot of people don't like subtitles. I find myself liking them because I've gotten to the point where now I can just whip right through a movie and watch the subtitles. Don't bother me at all. A lot of people, not going to watch a movie subtitles. So.
Yeah.
No, I think subtitles are worth, they don't bother me at all. I'd rather see subtitled film than actually see, than dubbed.
Right.
I did something with dubbing. When we go to Spain, everything's dubbed in Spanish. And
it just reminds me of a bad karate movie or something.
I was going to say, yeah, dubbing is for kung fu movies. That's where it belongs.
It just reminds me of kung fu movies. It just does.
I'm good with it there, but it should stay there.
That and Godzilla films.
Well, I always thought of Godzilla movies as like an extension of kung fu movies. You know, like they were probably just doing kung fu below while Godzilla was stomping on the buildings up top.
Yeah, my brother used to call them JAP productions when we were kids. he was horrible though. He still is. Yeah.
Looking up a bit of information about The Lodge, it is a 2019 American/British horror film with Alicia Silverstone in it.
Who is?
Oh, from from the '90s.
Clueless,
yeah.
Clueless.
But it did premiere in January at Sundance Film Festival.
It is out. It's called The Lodge.
Neon acquired the distribution rights to the film. But that's all the information about it.
It's not been released though.
Well, it has. I mean, it's done. It's been shown at the Sundance Film Festival.
Right.
5 months ago, so maybe there's distribution problems, or maybe check Netflix. Maybe Netflix will be showing this soon.
Yeah, Netflix
has got it all, that's for sure.
But any information I find on it, I'll make sure.
Let me know, because I'd like to see it, because I'd be interested in seeing more from this director myself.
Yeah, definitely.
So, Vicky, what is your final thoughts about Goodnight Mommy?
I thought it was beautifully filmed. Subtitles, yes, but it was great. It was really well done. It was kind of disturbing, yet, you know, you don't really know what's going on. So I'm probably going to have to, after our discussion, go back and watch it again, just so I can see those little nuances that I had missed that you were pointing out. But yeah, it's really I would say it's a must-see, because it's so well done, and it just kept me guessing the whole time. And I'm still kind of guessing, but you know, I mean, like I said, I'm going to watch it again to form my own conclusion. Like, I think anybody out there that's listening will watch it. It is your own conclusion, I think, with this movie.
And what about yourself, Will? What are your final thoughts about Goodnight Mommy?
It's very good. It's better than I thought it was going to be watching it a second time around, if that makes sense. When I saw that we were going to watch these two again, like, you know, I'm always psyched. I'm always down to sit through Brian De Palma.
Right.
With this one, I knew that I had liked it, but I didn't think I was going to like watching it a second time, because I knew what the big twist at the end is. But like you said, the twist doesn't make the movie. You really put it well, Keith. There's just enough going on that it's not, you know, you're not just watching somebody get tortured for an hour, like with a lot of movies. It's well done, and I'd recommend it highly to anyone.
And myself for Goodnight Mommy, I think it's one of those films, and the first time I saw it, I was like, you know, I read a lot about it and thought, okay, this is good, and I watched it. Kind of watched it again right afterwards to figure out why, you know, because I didn't quite get it. I said before, I didn't have my Mulholland Drive moment. And then I kind of forgot about it, and then didn't really think about it. And then as I was putting season two together, you know, we started out with The Other, because I love The Other and I love the book The Other. And I thought, okay, this would be good. Mm-hmm. And then we got Sisters, Brian De Palma carries through. And I thought, well, we could do Goodnight Mommy. It'd be quite interesting. So now watching it again, because this time I had to actually give some thought to it, because it's, you know, it's kind of weird. Most times I watch films and I just watch them and I either like them or not, but I don't give a lot of thought to a lot of things.
Right.
Doing the podcast, I find myself have to start giving thought. Then watching Goodnight Mommy the third time, I realized, God, this is a bloody brilliant film. I love this film. And it's actually become one of my favorites. Sisters has always been one of my favorites as well, because I love how weird it is. And I love to show people and they kind of look at it like, what the
fuck? It's weird, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah. But Goodnight Mommy, even though it has the same tropes that, you know, that The Other and Sisters has, I think it's probably a far superior film as far as it's simple, it's clear, but no simple answers. And that's what I like about Goodnight Mommy. And it's,
yeah, there are no simple, there really are no answers.
It's kind of like watching, to me, it's like watching Game of Thrones for the first two seasons. You can't really think about it because none of it makes sense. You don't know what the hell's going on. But if you let it wash over you, and then you find that you'll go about your day afterwards, and 2 days later, it's like it starts flashing in your mind, and it just kind of stays with you in a weird, uneasy sense. And that's what I like about it.
I watched last Sunday's Game of Thrones two more times.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm going to put both of you on the spot. So out of Sisters, the 1972/73 Brian De Palma film, and Goodnight Mommy, Vicki, which is the one did you prefer out of these two films?
I liked Goodnight Mommy. And what about you? I don't know. I kind of like movies with more scenery to them sometimes, because I've seen so many movies with the New York City backdrop, Staten Island backdrop, LA backdrop, Dallas backdrop. But when I see stuff, you know, with idyllic scenery and things like that, I'm kind of the country girl art, I guess. I like beautiful scenery. So that's one of the reasons I liked it. Also because those two, you know, little boys from the loins of Mengele, you know, yeah. they were just horrid, wretched, nasty little children.
Oh yeah,
I like bad children movies. I don't know why.
Probably because they remind you of your own childhood.
That's true. That's true.
What about yourself, Will?
I have to go with Sisters. I loved Goodnight Mommy, but Sisters has, if for nothing else than for Margot Kidder and Charles Durning, who are just both, you know, they're great. It's. It's always going to lean towards De Palma for me, unless you could throw another Charles or William Castle movie in there. I'm going with Sisters.
And myself, I think I'm going to go with Sisters because, I like yourself, I am a huge Brian De Palma film. I'm a huge Brian De Palma film. I'm going to watch people have sex through people's windows tonight. I'm a huge Brian De Palma fan. That's correct. I love Sisters, it shows the beginning of a great director. You know, I know that he made earlier films, but this shows him at the beginning of his craft, putting everything together that he's learned in film school and coming out with a sensational film.
Right.
Though I do like Goodnight Mommy, but I think, Brian, I have to go with a classic in this chance. Right. And though Goodnight Mommy is a sliver behind that, just a sliver.
Yeah.
So, well, we're not always going to agree, so there.
Yeah. So what I'm going to do is we're going to say goodnight to all our listeners out there and let you know that next week we'll be covering Stage Fright, the Alfred Hitchcock classic thriller with Marlene Dietrich, which is a film that Alfred Hitchcock said, was asked, what was it like to direct Marlene Dietrich? And Alfred Hitchcock said, I just let her direct herself because who could manage her? So it'll be interesting to talk about that next week. So I'd like to thank our guest, Will. So Will, would you like to give people where they can find you on social media or on the web?
Yeah, just look for me on medium.com. That's really where I'm concentrating everything now. Look for me there, or you can buy my books on Amazon, The Children of Judas Trilogy and Infernal Machines. And thanks.
And of course that will be located in our newsletter. Make sure you join up to our newsletter by subscribing. You go to www.llpodcast.com and join it to our subscriber list, and you will get a monthly newsletter that will have all that information. And of course all that information will be done in our show notes, which will be located wherever you're listening to your podcast. Just remember, you can also follow us on all our social media, which includes Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Reddit. And the list goes on and on. So if there's a social media platform out there that we're not on, let us know. So we'll make sure we're on that one as well. We're also known as the LL Podcast or the Literary License Podcast. So just remember that family is a very strong binds that binds us all together. Family is what we love. Family is what keeps us together. But when one of us dies, we'll make sure we keep that memory alive through murder. So that's me saying goodbye. So say goodbye, Vix.
Bye, guys.
Say goodbye, Will.
Goodbye, Will.
And we'll be talking to you next week for Stage Fright by Alfred Hitchcock. Bye-bye. Yes.
Elias! Elias! Elias!